It's a clever system we've devised in America here. We elect a new dictator every 4 years, but it's never a good enough dictator, right? So we're getting real jittery now because in a couple months we're going to elect our new dictator. But neither one of them is good enough. We want a great dictator. What the world needs is not democracy, it's a great dictator, actually, that dictates to us spiritual practice. This is what we need. We're just fooling around. It doesn't matter, you get Hillary or you get Donald, they're not good enough. Okay, they're not good enough. They're not nearly good enough. We're just more of the same fooling around in the materialistic swamp of the United States and the world. The guru is a dictator. Right, severely, but that's what we need, actually. In other words, the guru dictates to us, this is what you need to do to get used to being free of excuses. There's nothing else to do here. Okay, either we're making excuses for failing to accept what we are, which is freedom, or we experience our freedom. It's one of the two. And as long as we're familiar with excuses, We will feel this is the snake that gets us, all right? It's a subtle thing that gets us. And I always get back to familiarity. This is what trips us up, and we don't even realize it. All the spiritual talk in the world, they don't even realize. It's catastrophically stupid. And we do it lifetime after lifetime after lifetime. We study scriptures, we read religious things, we do some practices, meditation. We never realize the problem is familiarity. That's an insidious problem. This is what I discovered this lifetime. And so in order to free ourselves from this insidious problem, we most certainly have to be disciplined and have a guru that dictates to us, says, this is what you should do. Our, the inner guru, Holy Spirit. We need a Holy Spirit-centered society, actually. Okay, we don't... Trump and Clinton, these are petty dictators, petit bourgeois dictators, okay, like a Hitler or something. All these Stalin and Hitler, these terrible dictators, they failed because they were lousy dictators. They were petty dictators. Petty. Now, the Catholic Church is a little better than that, but not nearly good enough, okay? We need a Holy Spirit-centered society that teaches this, because the problem is one of familiarity. It's difficult to get this dictatorship because nobody realizes what the problem is, and they don't understand what the solution needs to be. So we just keep folly after folly after folly. It doesn't matter whether it's Clinton or Trump in the United States. They're both lousy dictators. Trump's a little better, okay, but they still, both of them fall into this very petty dictatorship. So why we're arguing over half of one and six, you know, half dozen, six of one, half a dozen of other. We're arguing over tomato-tomato between Trump and Clinton. They're both lousy dictators. Both lousy. Really lousy. And the 44 is even worse. Terrible. Terrible. Wishy-washy dictator. And we're all looking up to him saying, oh, finally we found our dictator. You know, what a joke. We found someone who wants to play the role of a dictator, but it's a lousy, lousy, lousy dictator. And so that's exactly what familiarity with excuses want. It wants more excuses. We want to continue with our excuses. This is all we're doing in transmigration, is we're simply continuing with our excuses. So this teaching is a little bit, not a little bit, but it's a higher level of teaching than what we're used to hearing. You listen to an ordinary teaching, you know, it's blah, blah, this and this and this, and you think, oh, okay, this is much clearer, and it gets it gets exactly to what the issue really is that we've been overlooking. Why are we overlooking this? Because we're terrified. We think that excuses are part of our identity. So we don't want anything, we don't want to talk about this. And no, I'll take a petty dictatorship and we'll just keep transmigrating when you do that. There's no question about it. And you keep complaining, you keep going, what a pain it is to lug this body around, huh? Feed it, lug it around. I mean, and you're just going to keep doing that. That's all. Struggling for happiness slips through your fingers. You just keep doing it and doing it and just looking for another petty dictator, another petty dictator. And the genius of the United States, it's an evil genius in some way. It says we change our dictators every 4 years, every 8 years. So, you know, everything's fine, right? You're not going to get stuck with one. Oh, this is a petty one? Okay, here's, we'll elect another one. Well, that's a petty one too. It's like the same model of car, if we get different colors though. And so we think like, this is a great place. We go in and get a junky car that's gray and go in and get another junky one that's black and then say, oh, wait a minute, I got a junky car that's yellow. It's like, wow, you know, what a great place it is, the USA. This is delusion. This is delusion. The USA is a swamp of materiality. It's terrible. It used to be a lot better. There was some discipline, and it came from religion. Religion is supposed to be the dictator over your life, but you better make sure it's a really great dictator. It's a belong to a church. The church is supposed to dictate to you what your life is, not the state. The state is a lousy, lousy dictator. Always. Terrible. Look at what statism has always brought us throughout history. Napoleon, you know, these lousy dictators, these petty petit bourgeois dictators who waste our time. Now the church is supposed to be a much better dictator of your life. It's, these are the rules. This is what you have to do. This is the Holy Spirit is the dictator of your life. The Holy Spirit gives you these practices. You have to practice this. You cannot do this. You cannot do that. These are necessary to discipline a very undisciplined psyche. Why are we so undisciplined? Because we're terrified that we might lose our excuses for failure. So we feel we have to keep failing. We're like professional failures. We're all very professional failures, which is called transmigration. And then we hide the failures for ourselves, hide the bones in a grave. And then we appear to be another. And it just goes on and 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 on. We can't get rid of our creativity. So if creativity is channeled into failure, we'll just keep failing. Failing to recognize our true freedom by having this ersatz freedom that we get. We're free to elect failure, a different brand of failure every 4 years. I mean, what is that? Now people turn to gurus because they realize, wow, I need a better dictatorship. And to greater or lesser extent, it's helpful. Some of, you know, they have problems, and in the USA it's problems because we don't accept that, you know, very well. We said, wait a minute, we're free to elect, our a different brand of failure every 4 years. Isn't that good enough? We're just going to elect a different brand of failure. Failure to realize that we're free. See, we think we're bound. We think we're not free. And we're trying to be happy with our bondage. And so we believe we have to fail to realize truth. We have to fail to realize truth. So our only question in the world asks is, how do we fail to realize truth in a way that makes us happy? This is exactly what the world is. How do we fail to realize the truth of our freedom in a happy way, in a contented way, in a comfortable way? What kind of petty dictatorship is going to help us with that? That's the only thing that's going through about everyone's mind here. And when we try to get free of that, we feel dull and apathetic and sluggish. Say, what's wrong with me? Well, that's fear. That's fear. That's called continuity fear. And so when we're evaporating this continuity fear, we will feel dull and sluggish and stupid and, I just can't get with it. What's the matter with me? But what we do is we flip that into the wow. And we say, no, I don't feel dull or sluggish. I feel wowish. Okay. You have this within your power to do this. It's simply a decision. It only happens when you decide for it to happen. And it's like night and day. It's like night and day. Like today, I woke up, I feel dull and sluggish and tired. Well, I've been working out on the Bosu ball, and that gets muscles that you didn't know you had. I mean, it's very effective. And I'm just stalled out, I think, of this. And I say, no. I'm in this super wow. I'm in a tremendous wow. Look at the progress I've been making. It's astonishing. And as soon as I accept that, the whole attitude changes. It's like I've shifted. I made a mental shift, but it's something you have to do intentionally. Okay, so you need to be your own dictator. You need to be skilled. That's why we need really great dictators to help us become our own dictator. So we become really skilled in saying, hey, wait a minute. This is what I have to do. I have to flip the script and accept the wow, that I'm in this profound wow. I'm not sluggish or lethargic or dull. I'm so inspired that it's wowed me. I'm not used to such inspiration, which is absolutely true. I've been on fire with inspiration. But this is just like when you work out tremendously. Guess what? You're going to feel achy and tired. Then you say, oh, I'm failing. I'm so lousy. No, you say, I'm succeeding. This is a good physical trainer. Like dictators, they say, hey, look, you say you're failing. No, you feel the burn. That's great. That means you're really getting to those muscle groups. You're really doing the job. And you say, oh, yeah. And then your attitude suddenly brightens up. And then you say, I'm only closing my eyes because the room is so bright now. You know, and if I could, I'll get used to it, though. This is great. So you keep your enthusiasm. You have to keep your enthusiasm, even in the face of this soreness, this spiritual soreness. Oh. Cross-training. We do 360-degree spiritual cross-training here. People love to get into some sort of habit and become robotic about it, but we do cross-training. If you want to ride the big waves, which we have to, the big wave is the wave of freedom, which is actually, we realize it's no wave at all. That's the biggest wave, isn't it? Because what happens is, we then imagine that the absence of a wave, we then imagine that somehow all waveness is somewhere else, and it's going to inundate us at some point. So we think we'd rather have all this choppy waves and stuff. We think, well, at least, you know, I'm some of the waves are being present here, so maybe they're not so big somewhere else. But if where we are is perfectly calm and still, we say, oh my gosh, all the kinetic energy is being stored up somewhere else, and there's going to be this gigantic wave come. This is not true. There's nothing to dissipate. There's no process to dissipate at all. There's no dynamic energy at all. Nothing is being stored up, actually. So in the meditation, we may be meditating on a peaceful, calm ocean. And we're practicing no waves coming in. But what builds up in us is we get start getting nervous. Because say what we say, well, if no waves are coming in, that just means when they do come in, they're going to be even worse. So we have to understand what we're doing, what the goal is here. Otherwise, meditation stalls out. And this is what's happened. Hindsight's very important in this world. That's why younger people should listen to their elders, the wise elders. There's a lot of foolish elders. Okay. Because the wise elders have hindsight, and they have an overall perspective, and they can see that if you meditate in a certain way, it stalls out. And so many have gotten to meditation, and they stalled out, and they're no longer into it. They just forget it, you know. This is what happens. So what we do is we accept the tidal wave, the tsunami of wow. Wow, there are no waves. That's the biggest wave of all. So we're not trying to suppress waves. Okay, meditation often is attempt to suppress waves. We're taking the position right from the beginning of meditation. There are no waves. There's nothing to suppress at all. And then this brings up the wow, we call it. The big wave of the wow. Because we're so used to excuses. Well, the waves are going to do this to us. The waves are going to do this to us. Those are our excuses. We have imagined all these waves, all this dynamic energy, this universe, as an excuse to not be what we are. Say, well, I can't be because of this excuse. But when we see that there is no excuse, the universe doesn't exist, actually. The way we view the universe as an excuse doesn't exist like that at all. No such entity. Then where are our excuses? So they don't exist, do they? Our excuses don't even exist. But this produces a wow because we think we're so used to imagining excuses. We believe our identity is based on excuses. And without excuses, we wouldn't exist. We wouldn't be. This is the catch-22. So, either way you look at it, you're going to be faced with anxiety. But what we do, we flip it into the wowness, and then it no longer is anxiety. It's wow. It's wowness now. It's a different feeling than anxiety. What happened with me was the world convinced me to, pressured me into in every 360-degree relentless propagandizing. I finally pressured me into flipping the wow into anxiety. And then I had extreme anxiety. And I then tried to figure that out, which doesn't work. What you need to do is you need to flip the anxiety into the wow. Like there's nothing to be anxious about at all. Absolutism. Flip it into absolutism. Now, there's still a feeling there. Okay. But now it's wow, the wow feeling instead of the anxiety feeling, the fear feeling. It's not fear anymore. It's different. It's intensity. It's this positive intensity. But you feel like, wow, I just need to sit quietly here as this reverberates. But it's enjoyable. It's like a burn. It's evaporation, like of continuity fear, you could say. But it's like a burn, it's like the heat burning off the fog. And you're just like, wow. So it doesn't, you don't feel depressed. With anxiety comes depression. With wow comes this confidence and trust. And good humor. And inspiration and clarity. This is what accompanies the wow. But it's a decision on your part, on our parts, to experience the wow instead of anxiety. We're going to have one or the other. The difference is anxiety just leads to more anxiety. Wow leads to realization of abidance. And we don't always have to explain. If we're feeling the wow, we just honor that. We honor that. So this is the type of dictatorship. We need a dictatorship that helps us discipline ourselves. We're so undisciplined. The world is, and we call it freedom. It's really pathos. It's trying to medicate anxiety is what we're doing. That's all we're doing in the world. Everybody's trying to find some way to medicate that anxiety. But when we flip that into the wow, we don't feel... the way we medicate that wow is we just sit quietly and allow the wow to, you know, this to settle down. And so we don't feel like we need to do all this stuff. The world is frantic, a frantic place, trying to escape this anxiety. And the anxiety comes from the feeling of threat that we might at some point drop our excuses. So we're frantic. We got to keep our excuses, because but there's something in us. We keep feeling there's something in us that wants to drop these excuses. And we say, that's crazy. We're so threatened from within. So we feel there's a threat within us, within our mind. And we're desperately trying to get rid of that. So we symbolize it through all sorts of illnesses and troubles, and then medicate, treat those illnesses. Oh, I got cancer, and now I beat cancer. You know, that's great. So I think I beat the threat. Oh, I'm gonna die. There's some threat to my life. Oh, I'm dead, but the death's dead and buried in the ground. So I beat that threat. It's gone. Oh, whoops, I've transmigrated. Well, no, don't say anything. We keep generating all of this. All this effort to get rid of this threat that is driving this anxiety. We said, God, I can't be without my excuses. I got to have these excuses. But there's something within me that seems to suddenly I see no excuses. You know, it's like, what? That's terrible. But you know, I'll lose myself. I'll be in an abyss. I'll be crushed by some mega wave because I don't see any waves at all. There has to be. So we're ignorant of what's going on. As long as we keep on seeing it as anxiety, we're ignorant. And we're just driven by our fears, and this is what drives the universe. The universe is driven. Transmigration, the realms, different realms, are simply driven by our fear. They're all fear driven. It's just fear driven. Fear drives the entire situation. But when you flip the fear into the wow, you're not driving the situation anymore. You say, I don't need any of this, actually. I don't need the realms. I don't need a universe. And then subject says, well, yeah, but if you're out of the universe, then the universe is somewhere. It's going to come. It's going to sneak up. No, the universe is nowhere. It's never been anywhere, actually. There's nowhere for space to be, right? Whatever arises is arising in its own intrinsic spaciousness from the beginning. So there's no space between that, you know, between an arising and its own intrinsic spaciousness. Where's the space there? Where's the time there? There's not even a tiny, tiny gap at all. Now, if you're in the wow, all of this resonates. It doesn't resonate at the level of anxiety and concrete mind, and the fear-driven considerations of anxiety. It doesn't resonate there at all, does it? So if you go back into anxiety, you say, what are you talking about? I can't understand it. As soon as you flip that anxiety into a wow, then everything that's being said here, it resonates, and you say, yeah. This is how I feel. It makes perfect. I get it. Yeah, this is true. Truth is true. How, you know, what a concept. Truth is true. What? Of course it's true. I just got to get used to the truth of it. You know, I've been with excuses, denying it for so long, that without this, you know, excuses, this bundle of excuses, I feel like I got to get used to that. Like, wow, I just lost, you know, 50 pounds and I feel so light and can move so easily. Now, going through this diet I've been on, I find you have to do it gradually because your body type changes. And the way you move, the way you do everything is different. And you have to get used to it. You say, wow. And if you don't get used to it consciously, keep working at it, you'll start eating more and gain the weight back. Because you say, I feel weird. But you feel better. Actually, I'm gaining a little bit of weight back right now. But I think it has to do with muscles that I'm gaining. I'm gaining some muscle mass, so that, you know, that's, I've gained a couple pounds that way. So I mean, athletes, they gain muscle mass, don't they? They gain some weight, but it's muscle mass. But if you get thinner, your movements are smooth and quick, and everything feels different to you. Feels different. It's like, whoa, what's this? So you have to be conscious of what you're doing. The key to success is you're conscious of what you're doing. Why you're doing it. That's why you need a benign dictatorship. A spiritual dictatorship, actually, is what we really need. Spiritual dictatorship. It says, this is what you're going to do. This is why you're doing it. And we're just going to keep on focusing on that. When you flip into the wow, you want guidance. You want guidance. When you're in anxiety, you're afraid of, you know, you're afraid of losing your excuses, so you don't want, no, I want to keep my quote-unquote freedom, my freedom to keep generating these excuses. This is what the universe is. They're just these realms of transmigration. It's just how we generate excuses. Lots of different excuses. You know, we fail to get rid of the threat in this life, and so we hide the body, hide the bones, transmigrate into another realm where we appear like, oh, I'm very successful at what I do. Yeah, you know, I'm here to be successful. What about your other lives? I don't have any. No. I've never failed to generate excuses. I'm really going to generate the right excuses in this realm, and that'll remove the threat, this crazy threat I have of dropping excuses. There isn't any. You know, what is that? Crazy. There's something crazy within me. So, no, I'm brand new and fresh, and I'm enthusiastic, and I'm going to succeed. I don't have any track record of failing to succeed at failure. This is transmigration. When you ultimately realize your transmigrations, You say, oh my gosh, I've just been failing. And that's when you really start to wake up. You realize, wow, it's all a scam, isn't it? This so-called death is just a scam. It's hiding failure to fail from ourselves. Death is hiding failure to fail. So we appear in another realm. We're born into another realm, another body, another form. And everybody says, oh my gosh, a brand new life has come into the world. Isn't this amazing? Maybe this is the one with great opportunity here to learn how to finally fail, so this inner threat is gone. The threat of no failure is finally defeated. The threat of no failure, this terrible darkness that we think is an abyss, we're finally going to defeat that. And everyone plays along. They say, no, this new baby here is brand new, freshly minted. They don't know failure to fail completely. They don't know any of that. So they've got a blank slate, and they've got just as great opportunity as anyone else. I mean, and there's this boosterism, this lying boosterism that you get when you come into any realm. You get this massive lying boosterism from everybody. Because they all want to, they're all in on this facade scam of death. Death is just hiding the failure to fail. That's all it is. Hiding the failure to fail. So when we transmigrate to another realm, everyone plays along, says, no, you've never failed to fail. No, you've got great opportunity to do it. Great opportunity here. That's what we're all about. We're going to get it done, aren't we? And you say, wait a minute, I failed every single time I failed. Miserably failed. And I'm hiding this failure from myself. I mean, why don't I look in to see why have I failed previously before I try to push again? Because every time I do the same thing, it doesn't work. See, when I realize my previous lives, this is what my realization is like, wait a minute. Who's ever been advising me has not been doing a good job at all. What is this? Throws the whole thing into consideration. I need to consider what's really going on here. So death is just this little scam we've used to hide failure to fail. Hide failure to fail. Now keep looking at this from the wow standpoint. Do not go back into the anxiety standpoint. So this is the key to your progress here. The liberation from transmigration. Liberation from death, absolutely, of course. And I'm seeing this, so that's a big wow. Okay, if I wonder, well, why do I kind of feel sluggish? Well, the wow is so extreme, isn't it? When we're able to see, hey, I'm going to be liberated from death itself. Because death, again, is just this hiding from ourselves, our failure to fail. But when we realize that failure is impossible, that excuses don't even exist, the ground for excuses don't even exist at all. When we can accept what we are without this bundle of excuses, when we get comfortable with our identity as not needing any excuses at all, because we're flawless, we're perfect, just as we are this instant, then there's no need for death whatsoever. There's no need for transmigration or death whatsoever. Now, the wow may get so strong, you start feeling sleepy. You have to fight against this. Sometimes opening your eyes is helpful. Sometimes your eyes close are so intense and you start feeling sleepy. Open your eyes. Open your eyes. This is not an indolence. Sitting quiet is a very intense. It's more intense than activity, actually. That's right. It's more intense than activity. It's the most intense activity there is, sitting quietly in the wow. So you really have to be a spiritual athlete. Everyone in this world, so many, are trying to be physical athletes. More and more and more and more and more emphasis on this. So when in Rome, do as Romans do a little bit. If you ignore that completely, you're in danger of suddenly flipping away from being a spiritual athlete. You'll abandon it. You say, well, I'm too far out of it. You know, this is too scary. It's too scary. But if you, like the Holy Spirit told me, look, you need to start working out and at least have some semblance that you're athletic. Otherwise, there's a risk of abandoning spiritual athleticism here. I understood what I was getting at. Now I've got all this physical cross training, you know, and we need to have some connection with doing something physical in this world as we really train as spiritual athletes. Otherwise, again, there's going to be this, a problem will arise. A stall out is likely to occur. Because the supposition of this world is, no, this is the way we're going. This is the direction. Everyone is going in this direction. So it's too difficult to stand up to the direction that everyone in the world is going in and say, hey, look, I'm not going in that direction. This is how we should go. It's too difficult. So what you have to do is pretend to be going in that direction. Say, yeah, I'm going in that direction too. But what you're really doing is you're being the spiritual athlete. So it does take a lot of effort. And, you know, like I say, the world's going towards yoga girl dictatorship, which is petty dictatorship. It's not good enough at all. It's not even remotely good enough, such dictatorship. They're terrible dictators, the yoga girls. They're awful. They're incompetent dictators. And yet they feel they've got a little bit of dictatorship in. But that's just momness. You know, mom is a terrible dictator. Very lousy. Dad's a little better if he really applies himself to it. My dad was a fairly good dictator. Fairly good. He was able to stand up to the mom pressure to some extent, but finally it was too much for him. You know, it was just, forget it. It's very difficult, especially now for men to stand up and be better dictators. And this is, it's almost impossible. The dictatorship of mom is almost complete in the world. And mom's a lousy, lousy dictator. Terrible. She vastly over-exaggerates her capacities as a dictator. Brags about it. It's just, oh, I'm so great, I'm so wonderful. Terrible dictator. She never even, wise culture realized this. They said, no, you need a lot better dictator than mom. Right now, the world is saying, no, all we need is mom. That's the dictator we need. Why? Because mom is so pulled down into materialism. So wishy-washy. And when mom tries to be better, she becomes very brittle. Just lousy. Mothers do not make good dictators. They make lousy dictators. And this is what this is a fact, isn't it? I mean, if you look at it this way, there's a little bird just cruising around here. In fact, two of them. Looking for seeds. Just hop, hop, hop. They spend all their time just hopping around, don't they? Run, hop, run, hop. Is that a seat? Is that a seat? Is that a seat? Yeah. I don't know. I don't dig that kind of life. But, you know, if we're saying this in the wow. If you're listening to this in the wow, you will hear what's being said and you'll say, wow. I've always known this intuitively, but no one's ever said it. I've never heard anyone say this. So I thought, maybe I'm crazy. And then I have to abandon the wow. You see, if everyone in the world thinks that you're crazy, nobody says it, the truth, then you think the wow is like, it's too far out. But if someone's saying this, then you say, oh, being in the wow is helpful for me because, yeah, I already know this is intuitive. I'm aware of this. Wow, that's great. Doesn't bother you at all. It produces a wow feeling, like, wow, that's right. So historically, men have taken the role of being the dictators because they make better dictators than women. But the mother aspect, women are lousy dictators. Too much pressure from the kids and just the way that they are. They're just lousy. And when they try to be good at it, they're even worse. Hillary Clinton thinks she's a really good dictator. She's terrible. She's absolutely terrible. But she has this sort of messianic diva zeal thing, like, I think I could be a really great dictator. No, Hillary, you're a lousy dictator. We don't want you because you're such a terrible dictator. You're an incompetent dictator. Petty, 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 petty dictator. So men make better dictators, but they're not good enough either. So what makes the best dictator? Holy Spirit and gurus make the best dictators. Those who are liberated from transmigration and death, those are the ones we need as dictators, okay? Men make lousy dictators because women control them. Say, no, hey, I don't want you to seem too much better than me as if a dictator, so, you know, you don't do too. And so, the way the dynamic of nature is set up is it keeps us from being good dictators. But fortunately, there are gurus. People think Anandamayi Ma is a nice, nice woman. Had to dissipate this intense for trying to sneeze. Ah, lovely, beautiful woman. They think, oh, she's so lovely. She's triangle, so beautiful. So, oh, yeah. I like a dictator. Like, ah, Ma, you're so wonderful. No, she's an extreme dictator, great dictator. But it's the guru that's the dictator, not the woman. See, they keep trying to look at her as a woman. And say, oh yeah, I'd like a dictator like this because I could kind of do whatever I want to do. Oh, you say, no. That's a facade. It was the guru in her that was such a good dictator. And she is you know, fierce. What a dictator. Guru. Gurus are the right dictators to have. You say, oh, I'm doing so much practice. She goes, really? You know, well, how you doing here? And she just absolutely will pin you and say, look, you see? Not so great yet, huh? Come on. You got to do more. It's always you got to do more. You got to do more. You got to do more. Relentless dictator. Relentless dictator. Scary, even. She's such a ferocious dictator. It might even be too much, you know? For me, really. I mean, wow. It's like, but basically what she does is says, look, you can either have this guru as a dictator or you can have me. And we say, I'll take this guru. She goes, okay, that's fine. That's great. So she's like such an extreme dictator that she scares us into the arms of the gurus. We say, you know, Ma, you're too much. So I'll take this guru's fine. Yeah. Yes, yeah. That's right. That's how it works, actually. She says, you can either have me or this guru. She's like a perfect dictator. You know, in our sense, our continuity fear can't quite handle that. So she actually pumped up our interest in gurus. This is what Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma did. The reason why we had such a great interest in gurus in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, there's a period like 50 years or so, the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, maybe 50 years. We had like a 50-year period where we were really interested in gurus, and we were all trying to find our guru. Why? Because Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and you could also say Ram Maharshi, but certainly Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma scared the heck out of us, because she says, hey, you could have me as a guru. Don't you want me as your guru? And we said, ah. She says, yeah, I mean, I'm here. I think you want me here, right? This is what you want, right? And we said, no. She said, well, it's either me or these gurus, isn't it? Isn't that true? Okay. We'll go to the gurus. Thank you. Scared the heck out of us. She put this in tremendous pressure on us. Scared the heck out of us. Because we realized, oh my gosh, that inner threat that we feel has suddenly appeared in the world. And so we said, how? We have to deal with this. And we said, well, maybe the gurus can finesse it a little bit. Okay, so it brought it to such a, externalized it to such an extent we couldn't hide from it. And so we thought, we have to deal with this some way. Maybe the gurus can help us deal with it. And so then we became very interested in gurus. And then we think we found some gurus that helped us deal with it, and then we lost our interest in the 2000s and 2010s. But for a while there, we were frantic. We were frantic. Yeah, we said, maybe Jesus is nicer than she is, a little more lenient. She had no leniency at all. Smiling, but no leniency at all. It's like, brutal. Total dictator. And so we say, maybe Jesus isn't quite as bad of a dictator, you know. And the Christians, you know, get scared of Jesus. They run to the Virgin Mary. They say, Virgin Mary, at least, which is Mom. They say, Mom, at least you're not as bad a dictator as Dad. And Dad is a little too tough. But then here comes Anandamayi Ma, and she's like even tougher, you know, totally tough. And then we go back, hey, Jesus, maybe you're not quite as bad as she is, you know. So for Anandamayi Ma is really responsible, in my opinion, that's the way I see it, for the great spiritual revival that happened over the last, 50 years, the last 16 or so, 20 years, we've dropped it pretty much. I'm sure she was responsible for me, A Course in Miracles, because I said, wow, Jesus, you're much better than she is. You're much more lenient than she is. She's too much, really. See, the problem is we're attracted to her, but then we get this dictatorship. You say, oh my God, this is horrible. What do I do? I'm attracted to something that's like too much. What do I do? Oh, here's Jesus. Oh, great. I'm attracted to you too, Jesus, but you don't seem quite as strict as she is. And so, yeah, it's like that. So it was a wonderful double teaming they did. Jesus and then Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma did this great double teaming on us. So I said, yeah, I'll take A Course in Miracles. Absolutely, I will. Just don't put me in the clutches of this of this Mataji, you know. Scares the heck out of me. Even now, I'm terrified. I mean, if she were to show up, I'd be terrified. And she says, want to come with me? You're going to be like moving every 3 days. And completely roughing it, you know, constantly, eating hardly and nothing, and having no money, and constantly, you know, are you kidding me? And then constant spiritual practice, constant pressure, relentless, relentless, relentless. Those who travel with her, they didn't look so happy. They said, this is just relentless, this is just brutal. Always so casual, she's always so casual, and just always so indifferent, always so aloof, so distant, always so, yeah. It's just relentless. And let's think, hey, Jesus, you know, you're not quite that bad, are you, Jesus, or that good, or, well, he is, but we imagine that there's some wiggle room there, you know, it's a relief. It's like some shade. And Anandamayi Ma is like this blazing sun. And the other gurus are like shade in contrast to her. This is the truth. And, you know, she comes to us and says, hey, how you doing? Say, I'm paying attention to Longchenpa. She goes, oh, good, 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 okay. Okay, you're in good hands. But if she comes to you, says, how you doing? And, I don't know. And, yeah, you know, I don't have any excuses. She's going to keep pestering me here. So, wow. So I better go with Longchenpa. I better get into a little bit of shade here, you know, otherwise she's going to, like, torment me. So that's great deal. Like, let Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma be the dictator of the world. And she'd scare us all into gurus. Paying attention to gurus, we'd be very diligent. And we'd say, thank you, guru, for a little bit. I feel a little bit of shade here. Oh, my gosh. Keep me away from Mataji. She's terrible. She's a blazing sun that never stops. Blazing. Yeah, I like the heat, but, you know, sometimes I like to get in a little bit of shade also. Mataji's the blazing sun of no excuses. Excuses don't exist for her. Never. She never made any excuse at all for her being this. Zero. Oh, we're not used to that, are we? We're not used to it. So we think, how in the world can I get used to that? Well, there's gurus, right? And all gurus help to some extent, you could say. There's some that cut us too much slack, and then we end up with a whole bunch of excuses. We know this has happened. Even Longchenpa's this blazing sun, too. It's like, good grief. Could be Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro. It's just not so blazing. But they're all blazing, you know. I said, good grief. Well, my own discipline, you know, maybe it's not quite as blazing. So then you accept your own discipline. You become your own dictator. And you cut yourself a little slack. Say, okay, I'll keep practicing. You know, man, it's like hiking in the heat of the blazing sun. I used to love that. I used to love the blazing sun. I was born that way. The hotter, the better. I love the relentless heat. But now, you know, getting older, I get heat stroke. I still love it, but I don't love getting heat stroke. Because then you feel really weak. And you feel scared of the sun. So the key is you need to make progress without getting heat stroke. You don't want spiritual heat stroke. Okay, this is why this way here has been introduced. I'm introducing it to the world because I have a understanding. I have a appreciation of our vulnerabilities, our fears, very much so. And also, I have an appreciation of the blazing sun of truth. So I'm able to keep working on this and presenting it to everyone. Is practicing full stop on the wow is this wonderful way of not getting heat stroke. Spiritual sunstroke, heat stroke. It's either that or you're going into a petty dictatorship. I'll tell you the truth. Because you can't handle the guru full on. You cannot handle it. You get heat stroke, spiritual heat stroke. You'll stall out. So you better then handle this practice. You're cutting yourself some slack without falling into the petty dictatorship of a Clinton or a Trump or a 44 or whatever. Right? They're all lousy dictators. They all, either it's mom's dictator, who's a terrible dictator, or it's dad, and mom is constantly after dad, saying, hey, don't make me look too bad here. Yeah, I know you're a little better dictator than I am, but don't overdo it. Don't make me look bad. And the man says, yeah, okay. So they make lousy dictators too. For the most part, but some pay attention to the gurus, and then they make better dictators. See, Anandamayi Ma said, no, I'm nobody's guru. I'm not a guru. Nobody could stand her as a guru. It's not possible. Not possible. So her job was to drive us into the arms of the gurus, which is what she did. Most people don't even realize this. I'm aware of it. Consciously aware of what happened. There was this buzz. I was aware of this. Something in India. I said, something in India is so powerful. It's driving us into, you know, towards gurus. You know, there's no doubt about it. And she'd go about everywhere to where there were gurus, and then she'd hang out with people, and then she'd leave so people wouldn't get spiritual sunstroke. And the people would then pay much more attention to the gurus. Says, oh my God. Because really they were shocked. They said, holy cow, someone like that can come in the world. That really blows the cover, my cover, completely. About excuses. I feel attracted to no excuses. I feel very attracted to no excuses. And then, oh my God, this is horrible. I mean, what do I do about this? I'm so attracted to it. Well, pay attention to the guru. And the guru say, okay, you can get used to this no excuses gradually. Now, the important thing is we don't practice getting rid of excuses. We practice getting used to no excuses. So this is the Ati Yogin approach. This is Longchenpa's approach. It's different. It may seem subtle, but it is different approach. It's the already there approach, which is really what Buddha advocated. The wise are already on the other side. They're already there. This is the approach that prevents stall out. The other approaches will seem to make progress up to a point, and then at some point they stall out. So you have then that generates religious traditions, with too much stall out, and so you're expected to stall out. Some make it through because they're determined, and they actually practice correctly. And then they're held up as icons of the religion. But most religion is based on those who have stalled out. And they say, yeah, you can make a lot of progress. I did too. But you can't quite get there. And people say, oh, good, because I don't really want to get there. I got to have some excuses, you know. So, yeah, you'll have some excuses. Don't worry, we all stalled out. Okay, great. Sounds like a good religion. So see, I'm speaking in the wow, not anxiety, but the wow. It's very intense. It's like, wow, how could you say this stuff? Well, only by abiding in the wow can you say this. I came in the world to say all this, but the world said, no, you have to have anxiety, not the wow. And then when I tried to say this stuff, it caused severe anxiety in me. So I was unable to speak. I eventually got to the point I couldn't even talk. That's so... But when I've gotten back to allowing this wow and feeling it as a wow, I'm able to speak all this. See, the cat walks by. The cat is so intent on, you know, the noises, the animals, the bird, doesn't pay any attention to me whatsoever. I can snap my fingers. It doesn't even, you know, just. That's like people. They're so intent on getting better excuses and learning to love their excuses. Petty dictators. Mom says, don't worry. I'll help you learn to love your excuses. That's what I'm here for. But don't worry about Dad. He doesn't know what he's talking about. You know, it's, oh, okay. That's what's going on. Is Mom and Dad running for president of the United States. Mom says, Dad, don't listen to Dad. Dad's an idiot. And he doesn't know what he's talking about. And Dad says, hey, look, you know, yeah, Mom, you know, she's, Mom's okay, but, you know, she's not as good as she thinks she is. I can help you out, make less excuses. I can help you with make less excuses. And then Mom says, Dad, what an egotist. He thinks he's so great. He's nothing, you know, I'm much better. And you get this juvenile, you know, this thing going on like that. They're both lousy. Okay, they're both lousy. Yeah, Trump puts up with less excuses, but not to a significant enough extent at all. He doesn't understand spiritual practice. He's not a guru. Okay, if you're not a guru, then you're living in fear, and you're going to just try and find better excuses. Just going to try and find better excuses, feel more comfortable with excuses. So. The thing is, when you're trying to teach, help others, they all assume that you're speaking to them from the position of anxiety. And they say, wait a minute, well, I can't do that. You're asking me to. No, we're never speaking in that context. So context is everything. So we're speaking from the context of wow, already there. Not we're generating less excuses, but we're practicing not having any excuses. We already have no excuses. No excuses. So we're not trying to get rid of excuses. We already don't have any. We're just practicing getting used to that. So when excuses arise, etc., they don't arise so much. It's the wow that arises. Wow, I don't have any excuses. And that's the one excuse that we have. So all excuses are bundled into just this one excuse. I have this wow reaction. Okay, but we can gradually, what that does is it evaporates our continuity fear. So my mind isn't struggling with all these excuses that it used to, and anxiety is nothing but struggle. Now, I don't struggle like that. What I do is I keep bringing myself back to practicing. What the wow, that's it. But I don't have the mental struggle that the people of the world have. My mind is not like that anymore. That goes together with anxiety. How do I get better excuses? My excuses aren't working as well as I want them to do. How do I get better excuses? How can I make the excuses permanent? How can I be happy with my excuses? How can I? That's the torment of the mind in anxiety. The mind in the wow doesn't have that torment. There's still the day-to-day, you know, functioning in the mind, how do I, you know, but it's not anything like the anxiety mind. It's not anything like that. It's simply the train of thoughts don't go anywhere. You know, it's like the trains are in the station, but they don't really pull out of the station. Or if they start to go out of the station, kind of like, you know, they just kind of stop. So yeah, there's all these excuse trains in the station, but they're not leaving the station. In other words, they're not There's no momentum. They're not generating momentum. And then you start generating momentum. Where are they going? Where are we going? Oh, we're on a trip. Or we're going down their tracks. Where are the passengers? You know, what's the journey going to be like? Where, you know. Now, if you don't, if the trains don't leave the station, you know, where's all your thinking, all that thought about, you know, where's all these trains coming? Here's new trains coming into the station. Now, passengers getting on, they're leaving. If the trains don't leave the station, the passengers get off the train, don't they? Say, oh, it's not going anywhere. So all this hubbub in a train station, it's just not there anymore. It's just an empty train station with a bunch of trains in the station. There's a few, maybe someone's going sweeping a platform sweeper, going around kind of sweeping a little dust, keeping the dust. And somebody goes inside the trains and lubricates them, and dusts them, you know, cleans them, keeps them in working order or something, you know, a little bit, but paints them or something, you know, up. But after a while, no trains leaving the station, the passengers stop coming to the station. So I'm just like sitting on a bench in this empty train station. Trains aren't moving. Nobody's coming. Nobody's in the station. And I'm just sitting there. Wow. Getting used to this. Getting used to trains not leaving the station. No passengers boarding the trains. The doors could be open of the trains. It's like, you know, it's not like they're shut out, but nobody, you know, the trains aren't going anywhere. Nobody's going. Okay. So this is a great meditation, okay? Is imagine yourself in this Grand Central Railroad station, you know, whether in India or United States, wherever you live, where it's just a massive amount of tracks and trains coming in, and you're sitting there and there's nobody there. Maybe a sweeper, two cleaner, two. Maybe there's a stall for food that you can go get some food, a vendor, but nothing else. No passengers. You're just sitting on a bench and you're looking at where all the trains are. So many trains there. And they're all just sitting there. Now, initially, you might have the engines on, like the engines. You can hear. Okay. So you think, well, they could go somewhere. So this is how you could start out. They could go somewhere. And ultimately, as you practice more and more, the engines turn off. They're just quiet, more and more quiet. You say, well, they're not going anywhere. But they could. Okay, so this is a beautiful meditation. Really, really powerful. The train station meditation. So the trains are there. You say, well, they could go somewhere. They're just not going anywhere right now. So let me just see how long I can hang out here. See what happens. And so you hang out half an hour. Still don't go anywhere. You hang out for an hour. Still don't go anywhere. At some point, you start getting nervous. Well, the nervousness is building up in you into a wow. Don't do an anxiety. Go into the wow of it. Wow. They haven't gone anywhere. That's extraordinary. Now, don't say, maybe they're never going to go anywhere. That gives you sunstroke, spiritual sunstroke. No. So the secret is to say, wow, they haven't gone anywhere for 2 hours. I've been sitting there for 2 hours, and they haven't gone anywhere. Wow. And just wow that fact. So we're really getting very clear about this. Which is super important. You just wow the 2 hours. This is why putting time in to your meditation is so important. Of no, because it builds up into this wow. Of and then it makes sense. You say, wait a minute, I 2 hours, I haven't gone anywhere. That's a big wow. That's astonishing. Because in the back of your mind, What's starting to emerge? You don't measure it, but Do you say, oh my gosh, yeah, 2 hours, I haven't gone anywhere. You don't need to go further than that. You just wow the 2 hours. You come back the next day, you do 2 more hours, and the next day 2 hours. And then at some point you say, hey, you know what, it's been a week and they haven't gone anywhere. And then you wow the week. And then you keep coming back every day. And then you wow, it's been 2 weeks. And you keep coming back every day. And then it's been a month. And then you wow the month. You say, wow, I'm sitting here and I know these trains haven't moved in a month. And then just wow the month. No more than that. So you see how everyday practice starts compounding itself in a beautiful way. Because now you're able to wow months. Do this for a year. And then you say you haven't gone anywhere for a year. And now you're able to wow a year. You say, yeah, I'm comfortable with trains not going anywhere for a year. No problem. I'm used to that. Do it for 10 years. And you say, yeah, I'm used to for a decade. The trains don't go anywhere for a decade. That's no problem for me at all. And you see how then this can be, how this expands. And if you do this for a lifetime, you say, yeah, I'm no problem at all. The trains don't go anywhere for a lifetime. I've done it for a lifetime. And then you say, well, wait a minute. I don't need another lifetime. I mean, I'm comfortable with trains not going anywhere for a whole lifetime. Then another lifetime would just be the same. It would just be repetitive. I don't need another lifetime at all. Doesn't bother me at all if trains just don't go anywhere for another life. So well, I could just stay going with this lifetime. So you see the genius of everyday practice is that's the real savior. The real savior is everyday practice. Because it compounds and you don't stay, well just today I did 2 hours a day, wow. You've already used to that. Now you realize, oh yeah, doing a year of this for another year, yes, that doesn't bother me at all. If they don't move for another year, I'll wow that, but it doesn't really frighten me so much. And then if you do a lifetime of everyday practice, you realize having a life where the trains don't move doesn't bother me at all. So I can just sit for another lifetime of just stillness and peace and quiet. That's fine with me. That's fine with me. I don't need the turmoil. So I certainly don't need a body with the turmoil that it brings and the death that it brings and all of that. I don't really need that at all. I could just put in another 60 years, but 60 years is easy. Maybe I'll put in like 100 years or 200 years or something of just peaceful abiding. And then maybe 200 years, that's easy. But I'll put in 1,000. 1,000, that's easy. I'll put in, you know, 1,000,000. And then that it, you know, expands like, you know what, I'm not going to quantify it. 10 billion, trillion, you know, say something, but I don't even need to, I'm not even concerned anymore about quantifying at all. I'm just comfortable with the trains not moving. So you don't have to quantify as eternal. Don't go there, because you're still practicing the wow. Still practicing the wow. Leave it open-ended. Don't project like, wow, I've done it for a year. Maybe I can do it for 10 years. Don't do that. Just wow the year that you're doing it. Like, wow, it's a year since the trains haven't moved in a year. Wow. Just stick with that. And then automatically, once you're comfortable with that, automatically it will start extending and generalizing itself. And you'll feel more comfortable with the train's not moving for a longer duration. And you'll feel more and more like, you know, I'm not even worried about duration so much. Wow. And then wow that. Like, and what are we getting closer to? When we get less and less concerned about duration of how long the trains have been in the station without moving. less and less concerned about measuring anything like that. What happens? Now stay in the wow. What we're doing here is we're saying, laying out the case for everyday practice, which the intellect driven by anxiety will never do. Will never do it. They'll stall out. They don't understand the purpose behind it. So they might have a big push and use the yoga girls to attract them to meditation for a while. Yoga girls have a nice business. They make a lot of money. And then merchandise and all. And go into a new age store and there's all these clothes and, you know, you can, nice little crystals and bells and everything. And yeah, but you stall out. Because you don't understand what you're doing. Don't understand the purpose of it all. Everyday practice is only that works. Because what we ultimately getting to is the realization that the trains never left the station. Nothing has ever gone anywhere. And therefore it's impossible to have any genuine excuse. Totally futile. Totally futile. There aren't any real excuses at all. Never will be. This is ultimately the realization. But this is a realization that's so absolute, the intellect simply stalls out immediately back into threat, feeling of threat, and needing to get rid of that threat. It portrays this inability, no excuseness, as a threat, and it needs better excuses. It will immediately stall out and feel I need the excuse of needing to conquer this threat. I'm the light and this is the darkness. I must defeat the darkness. It portrays nothing has ever happened as some darkness, some dark threat to its happiness, thinking that it's an abyss of excuses. Thinking, I'm not myself. If this is true, then I'm not what I thought I was. Yeah, no, it's not what I tried to change myself into. Just meaning I failed to change myself into something different. That's all. The wow understands this. The wow gets this easily. This is easy. When you accept the wow, it's easy. Jesus said, my burden is easy. It's easy. When you repent and choose the wow, all this is easy. It's not difficult. For the intellect, it's very difficult. Because it's thinking, you know, what kind of excuse can I generate when I see that there's no excuses? Intellect's thinking, wow, this is really difficult. How am I going to do this? And so it's always planning its escape hatch on the spiritual path. It's stall out. What it's really working on the whole time is its stall out. How do I stall out in a graceful way? That's an effective way. How can I stall out in a really effective way? That's all that happens. You see all the hippies, the hippie gurus, those, everyone who's into this, they've all managed to find a way to stall out in some which they think is a graceful way. And then I come along and it's not graceful at all, folks. And like, what? Who are you? No, I did a very graceful stall out. No, you didn't. It is disgraceful. Disgraceful. All stalls are disgraceful, actually. All the children of the last 50 years, all of us, you know, most of them have stalled out. And they just want someone to tell them they did a graceful stall out. And that's Hillary Clinton. She's going to say, hey, folks, I'm one of you. I understand you. Two thumbs up. You did a really graceful stall out. You know, it's wonderful. It's great. Oh, thank you, Hills. So, wow, that's just what I wanted to hear. Whereas Trump says, you morons, you know, terrible stall out. No, we don't want to hear that. No. The problem is that Trump has his own disgraceful stall out planned, you know. So he's not a guru. So at least I have the right option. But so nobody gets mad at me, but they just don't listen. That's how we could ignore him. That's okay. I'm not, you know, threatening to take over the world, so to speak. But they look at me and say, does he think my style's graceful? I say, no, it's actually it's disgraceful, but there's an alter. The wow is alter. Huh? Oh. Well, okay. Not going to pay attention to that. Unfortunately, we have to do better than that. So the children of the guru era have stalled out. They hope that all they want is someone to tell a dictator, petty dictator, tell them that they did a graceful stall out, and they think that then they'll die. And they think I'm die happy, die happy. And there's a lot of quote unquote gurus in the world right now who are, their business is just to reassure everyone that quote unquote went on the path. Hey, you did a nice stall out. I really appreciate your stall out, because I did a good stall out. You did a good stall out. My stall out's okay. Your stall out's okay. We're okay with one another. Have a happy death. And we'll see you in the next realm. And thank you. Give me a hug, you know. It's like, what a guru, you know. Wow. Isn't this true? So, you know, I have a sense of humor about it and a lightness about it. And so this is what you have to have. I hope it reaches some of us. And you can redeem your stall out by simply start practicing it in the wow. Just decide you're gonna experience the wow, and just start doing that every day. And you know what? Right away, you'll realize you just redeemed your life. And you realize right away that someday, not too far away, you will feel no regrets at all. And this is a very big wow, isn't it? It's such a big wow. You don't run to the guru. You're not going to run to me and say, oh, thank you so much. Give me a hug as well. No, you will not. That's but you're back in anxiety and the ego then. You're going to be so wowed by it. You're just going to be sitting quietly. And you're not going to be saying much of anything. Because you realize for yourself that you're going to be free of all regrets. You know it. Why? Because you took the step of deciding to feel the wow instead of anxiety. The wow of already there-ness. You're an Ati Yogin now. A genuine Ati Yogin. You're not kissing the rear end of someone who claims to be an Ati Yogin. Okay? You yourself are already an Ati Yogin. You yourself, through your own practice, are going to be completely free of regrets. So I don't have this big need for people to come to me and say, oh, you're such a great guru, and, you know, all this guru worship stuff. What I'd rather see is people practicing and being quiet in the wow. And you don't need all this guru eye contact, look into my eyes. No, forget that. I don't need people looking into my eyes. You know, I don't need all the entertainment. I can entertain myself. You know, I could sing a song. I could put on George Jones and just sing along, and I feel great. Or the Beach Boys or something. I could keep whatever I need some entertainment. I could do that. I don't feel this big need for that, you know, guru worship thing. So if you're really practicing, you don't really go in for that guru worship thing. You don't go in for it. Because you're feeling such a powerful wow, all you want to do is just sit here quietly and just feel the burn. Wow, I could sense, I could get this feeling that I'm going to be free of all regrets pretty soon. And it has nothing to do with dying at all. Nothing to do with it. Wow. Conscious, free of regret. Consciously free of all regrets. I can feel that. That's my destiny now. So what you did, as soon as you feel the wow, decide to feel the wow instead of anxiety, you've completely changed your destiny. You become aware that you have a different destiny than you did before. And that destiny is one that death plays no part in it. No transmigration, no regrets, no excuses. You're going to be free of all regrets, as well as free of death. You know it right away. This is your destiny. And you don't say, oh, guru, you're so wonderful. You did something for me. Let me give you a hug. Then you're not focused on the wow at all. You're back into the ego and the intellect and stuff. Because, again, the real gurus, the gratitude that they're looking for is your own freedom, your own practicing. They say, yeah. You know, they're thrilled to see you getting it. That's their payoff. They're thrilled to see that. Jamyang Kensi Chogyi Lodro came to see me and, you know, gave me this huge hug, and he was just crying. He's so thrilled, you know, to see someone practicing effectively. He didn't say anything. That's a different kind of hug. That's a guru hug. And maybe he didn't even need to hug. Maybe he didn't need to hug him. He just was there just crying, you know. He's just like, wow. So don't think you have to do this new age, it's not really new age, it's been going on, of, hey, I stalled out, I did a graceful stall out, you did a graceful stall, let's give each other a hug. Like, oh, I found a graceful stall out, that's wonderful, I'm so happy. We don't have to do that. We don't have to do that at all. So we have all these structures of mutual stall out, you know, appreciation that we think are guru, disciple, spiritual past stuff. It's not. It's not. And the ego tells us that's what you got to do. Of course the ego's going to say that. You got to have a graceful stall out. The ego's all about graceful stall outs. So of course the ego will seem to practice, but always in the back of the mind, it's planning its graceful stall out. Always. But when you practice the wow, that's not there. It's gone. And then that's a huge wow, isn't it? Wow. All these trains leaving the station are just excuse trains. Stall out trains. Say, well, where are you going to take your stall out retirement? Oh, I'm taking a train to this place. Oh, that's a nice place. I like that. Yeah, I'll go visit you sometime. I'm taking this over here. Oh, that's good too. Yeah. But you're sitting in the station and the trains aren't going anywhere. Wow. Where'd you stall out? Well, I stalled out in Florida. Oh, yeah, that's nice. Yeah, got a nice place on the golf course there. Oh, great. How about you? Well, I'm up in the Adirondacks. You know, it's really beautiful country up there. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I got friends in the Catskills. Oh, yeah. Sweet, yeah. Yeah, Washington, Mountains of Washington. Oh, that's a great stall out place, yeah. I was thinking about that too. Yeah, I got a really nice sweet place there. Got some spiritual books in the library, you know, and they do some hikes and grandchildren. I mean, it's a great stall out. And once a year, you know, we do a retreat in Hawaii with gurus such and such, and we all pat each other on the back and says, you know, that was a really graceful stall out, you know, that, and you know, I feel that may work. You know, we'll see this death, how this death works out, but this may be the stall that I was looking for, you know, and thank you so much, guru. And the guru says, oh, thank you, you know, you really helped me too, because I was kind of nervous I might actually, you know, get free of excuses this lifetime, but I was able to find, you helped me with a real graceful stall out too, you know, and so, hey, another hug, you know. It's wonderful. We got all these nice, you know, accoutrements, and got the labels down, and, you know, wow. You know, hopefully this is it, right? This is the stall out, and we'll have permanent excuses, and nobody will know as we transmigrate. Nobody will know, you know, that we failed, right? Yeah. All right. This is what's going on. I mean, it's pretty funny when you see it. It's. I choose to have humor about it instead of pathos about it. Otherwise, you're going to just really get very. It's going to be very pathetic, you know. I don't want to feel that. So I try to see it in a humorous way so we laugh. We have to be able to laugh at it. Because we get to our life, we get to the point where we say, wait a minute, I think I screwed up again. And we all want to find some guru who says, no, you didn't. Give me your hand. I'm in, you know, hospice. Let me get your hand, you know. You didn't screw up. You did a great job. It was a very graceful stall out. Right? I got your back. Because I'm going to have the same type of graceful stall out. And after all, I'm guru, baba, baba, this, that, you know. Swami, na, na, da, ba, da, da. And, you know, I'm going to have the same stall out, man, you know. We're together in our stall out. We're friends in our stall out, right? Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for coming and letting me know that it's, that you know, it. I did have a graceful stall out. It's okay. It's okay. Yeah, it's okay. But I still feel like I missed something in my life. It's okay, I missed something too. We all miss something, you know? We're all... This is how we all feel. Right? Okay, why not talk about this, folks? I mean, why not? Because this is exactly the dance we're doing, isn't it? So at least we should be aware of the dance we're doing. Maybe we need to throw in a little two-step, you know, cha-cha-cha. One, two, 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 cha-cha-cha. I may even try that today. Right? Yeah, I could see how that works. So, we might even throw it. Maybe I'll go try that. Let me go try the cha-cha-cha for a second. I'll be right back. Cool, I just did the cha-cha-cha. I never done that before. I know how to do the cha-cha-cha. I just figured it out in my mind. I just figured it out. Wow. Maybe I'll be doing the frug next, you know, or something. Oh, yeah. Yeah, probably. Why not? Or is that the swim? Is the swim the frug? What's the difference? I don't know. I never understood the difference between the Watusi, the frug, and the boogaloo, and the swim, and the shiggling. I know there wasn't a twist, you know. But so let's see, we're not condemning ourselves here. We're looking at it with humor and wowing it. Like, wow. So we can be aware of our little dance we're doing here, can't we? We're doing the cha-cha-cha. Okay, let's consciously do the cha-cha-cha and make sure we know. Okay, and maybe do a little back step from that. One, two, three, the back step, step, cha-cha-cha. Front step, step, cha-cha-cha. So side cha-cha-cha, back step, cha-cha-cha. Forward cha-cha-cha. We can go forward with the cha-cha-cha. Wow, that's great. Now, in my mind, maybe I should go do that again. Strike while the iron's hot. So refuse to look at this as pathos. Refuse to look at it. The guru is not in the pathos. That's the real guru. Knows you're just one insight away from settling it all. And transmigration doesn't change that in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. There really is no death. There's just transmigration. So anytime, any point, you can start the wow and just say, instead of anxiety, the wow. And you immediately become aware that it's already settled. You're just not used to this fact. All of it settled. All regrets have already been settled. It's all settled. I'm just not used to that. All excuses, gone. I'm just not used to you. So then you just spend your time getting used to this. Very nice way to use your time, isn't it? Now, having seen through this, that's a big wow, isn't it? So you wow that. You see, you keep wowing your success. So you have to be conscious 24/7. You have to be conscious of where you're at. See, don't just fall into this storytelling in your mind. No, I'm in the wow. I just had this tremendous breakthrough here. It's true. Seeing the dance that we're doing here, that, you know, that's extraordinary, isn't it? Extraordinarily helpful. Ah, I'm getting summoned. Moment.
was the, okay. We'll, I'll deal with that.
Trivial. People think nothing of interrupting something this profound because they see no profundity in it whatsoever. So you can understand why when you're on this path, you need to kind of isolate yourself from the world because they have no clue. Like, oh, you just waste your time. No idea what you're doing. No, you know, there's a fly over here. Come here, hey, there's a fly here. You know. I have to put up, you know, my whole life's like this. Food. We gotta have some food. Oh, we just got free of death here. Ah?
Is it still going?
Yeah. Well, I made lemonade out of the lemon. But I did the cha-cha-cha forward and backwards. I said, oh my gosh, you can do it forwards, you can do it backwards, you can do it sideways. Holy cow. I'm gonna be cha-cha-chaing all day today, actually. Yeah, one step at a time. I have no clue how to dance, but now I see. I could do the cha-cha-cha. Oh my gosh, this is amazing. I skipped dance class. I flunked dance class in high school. I didn't want to dance. I hated dancing. I wanted to just sit still. Because that pulls you into the whole thing, doesn't it? Of course, the girls love dancing. They just love it. Oh, let's dance. Let's go to the dance. I never went to a single dance in junior high school. High school never went to any dance. Zero. Because that's the socialization that, you know, pulls you into the world of excuse making. So I just avoided all that socialization entirely. Never went to a football game. Never went to a dance. Nothing. I attended no social functions in school whatsoever, zero. I attended graduation, I didn't want to, but I realized if I didn't do that, my, you know, family would really think something's wrong with me, so I don't even have my diploma. I threw it away, I'm sure. I have no interest in school. I had no interest in education, I had no interest in the social life, zero interest in any of it. I have interest in what I'm doing right now. That's what I wanted to do then. But people said, no, you can't do this stuff. You got to be, you know, ancient. And they have some image in their mind of someone with white hair and a white beard. And, you know, but a kid, you know, say this stuff? No. That can't do that. What they really were saying, don't say this until we're dead and gone. You know, that's what they're really saying. Wait until we're dead and gone. And I said, yeah, well, okay, I've waited, and you're still not dead and gone. Why are we supposed to wait until I'm almost dead and gone? This is ridiculous. Because the whole idea is you're never dead and gone. Okay, so this saying, wait until I'm dead and gone, is meaning saying, I don't want you to ever teach. Ever. What's that? That's not a request, that's a demand. It's an unreasonable demand. It's a demand, basically, that I don't exist. Have no role, no function at all. That's a hideous demand to make. Because dead and gone doesn't exist. But you see, the problem is when you're young, they think you're being unreasonable because you're not giving them a chance. You say, you know, this is the problem, isn't it? That's why it's so difficult to teach when you're young. Very few are able to do this. Because you got your whole life to teach. You can teach sometime later. You know, what's the hurry? You know, we're gone through it. You know, meaning, you know, give us more time to design our stall out. We could do better. I said, no, I'm here to tell you that the stall outs, no stall out works. That's just a scam, ridiculous scam. No, I got time, you know. So when you're young, you got your whole life ahead of you, they use that against you, the world does. But now that I'm going to be 60, you can't use that anymore. You know, what can they say? They just ignore me. But it's a scam. They said, shut up, you're young. If you want to teach this, teach it when you're older, when I'm not around. And you could wait that long. You'll still have plenty of time. People would be 100 now, you know, I'll be 80. Guess what? You know, that's life wasted, right? So they're just a scam. This whole world is a scam to get you to not teach the truth, not profess the truth in this world. They don't want to hear it. They say, well, how do I do a graceful stall out of that? I already have done it. They say, no, I've already got the graceful stall. I've done it. I'm almost there. Just hold on. I almost got it. That's the ego, the intellect is always saying, then I'm working on my stall out. I think I'm going to get it, and then everything's going to be fine. No, I said, but my whole point is to show this, bring it to light that you're not fine. You're just going to transmigrate, and no excuses work at all. So you just continue with your anxiety and fear, that shadow, and double down on your excuse making. This is just utterly pathetic or humorous. We look at it as humorous. Let's look at it in a humorous way. Flip the script into the wow. And then you realize, oh, I'm already free. I just got to get used to this. So, in looking in hindsight, I realized that trying to teach this when you're young is supremely difficult. Only someone like Anandamayi Ma or Jesus can do that. It's so difficult. So difficult. Even when you're 60, it's so difficult. Nobody will listen to you. But when you're young, people say, we don't want a lifetime of this. Maybe we can handle when you teach when you're 80 or something. But if you start teaching now, we'll be hearing this for 60 years. This is terrible. We don't want that. How can we work on our graceful stall out when we're hearing this truth? Terrible. So they don't like it. I mean, they really don't like it. I mean, they're very cross about it. Very cross about it. Ferocious about it. So what are we going to do with this kid? We can't have this kid professing this stuff for our lives. That'll ruin our lives. We won't have a graceful stall out. And this whole death thing isn't going to work for us properly. You know, we've devised this very clever little trick of death. We think, believing that we die, and that'll ruin it. What are we going to do without our belief in death? That's terrible. And again, death doesn't exist. There's only transmigration, actually, that takes place in this dream. So death's our little, we protect death, the belief in death, we protect it at all costs. It's supremely important to us, we think. Because it makes it all seem possible, like maybe, you know, we're succeeding somehow. Without death, we realize we're not succeeding. You know, we're not succeeding. That's when I saw my previous lives, I realized, holy cow, this doesn't work. I'm not succeeding. I'm not getting anywhere. So this delusion of death is what this world prizes the most. So I told people, I'm not going to die. But I mean, nobody can die, actually. Nothing dies. Nothing dies, and one insight settles it all. Wow. Cha-cha-cha. So we're not all sunk in pathos. You're like, oh my God, our little scheme of death didn't work. No, we're full of humor here and laughter. Right? CrossFit spiritual training here. We're not robots. We look at it this way, this way, this way. So you're not going to just be all morbid, like, oh my God, I can't die. That's like terrible. It's horrible. Yeah, it doesn't work. If we refuse to feel the wow, we will feel that way, sure. Because then we're asking the intellect, hey, the intellect, you know, still in the ego's in charge. Hey, ego, you don't work. You're stupid. Oh my God, that's horrible. I feel so terrible, but I can't, nothing I can do. This is just, but if we just wow it, then we don't feel that way at all. Suddenly we go from morbid depression to a laugh. A laugh. Cheerful laugh. Yeah. Just like that. My gosh, if I'd have known that, I would have never suffered in this world. But the world tries desperately to deny that. No, you're depressed. Oh, you got to go through all this. You're anxious. Okay, you got to figure out your life, what you need to do with your life. Nobody ever told me just shift the anxiety to a wow. No one ever told me. I read every psychology book and studied everything. You know, I was just voracious. Nobody gave me the right advice. I could have flipped the script into the wow at any instant in my life, any instant, just like that. That this is what is so buried. This is what the world tries to avoid at all costs, this information. So even now that the information is given out, almost no one's paying any attention, just a few. Because in their mind, there isn't any such information. They're frantically busy in this horizontal way of trying to generate some better stall out. A more graceful stall out there. Everyone's frantic. And so you stay on this frantic train. The train goes faster and faster. It's frantic, going around turns. Wow. Everyone's on these trains that are going real faster and faster and faster. And you know what happens when a train goes around a turn too fast, don't you? The whole world is like a train going around a turn too fast right now. Get a train wreck. Which is just the worst, you know. It's just... Don't pay attention to the train wreck. We don't need to. We have the wow. If you have the wow, you don't need to pay any attention to the train wreck at all. It doesn't affect your humor at all. Because you know there's no death. It's only transmigration. And we can be liberated from transmigration by just into the wow. The wow realizes I'm already free. All I have to do is get used to this. Everyone is just one shift away from zero regrets. Okay, so... why wallow in regrets? There's no point to it at all. None. Zero. Don't So don't even pay attention to the world. The world is just the attempt to generate regrets. You know, really, but graceful regrets. Okay, so we're all trying to generate graceful regrets for failure. Yeah, I failed, you know, but I have, it's a graceful regret. You see these elder people, you have to pay attention to your elders, the ones that fail. Look at them, and they're trying so hard to fail gracefully, to have graceful regrets. The ladies still go to the beauty parlor. They're 95, and they're still putting the makeup on, and the hair is done up nicely. They're dressed very nicely, like they're still the belle of the ball, homecoming queen. And you see in their eyes, they're saying, they're looking at everybody, and they're saying, am I a graceful failure? Can you just tell me I'm a graceful failure? My failure is graceful. Can you just do that for me? I really need that help. Just tell me, right? Stiff upper lip. And if you're in your kid, you just say, oh my God, you're failing. I know it. You know, why do you have graceful failures? What? You wretched little boy. You're awful. Awful mean boy. You see how tough the pressure is? Don't say that to grandma or auntie. You know, terrible. You're a very wicked boy to laugh at that. You know, that's what you get. Just tell them, no, one insight settles it all for you. You're just one insight away from zero regrets. From as if no regrets ever existed. You're just one insight away. Somebody has to tell the world that, right? Without hearing this, we're doomed. We continue in our doom march, our endless death transmigration march. You know, it's like the Bataan death march, except it never ends. It just keeps going on and on and on. You drop by the side of the road. You think you die, but then you get up. You suddenly you get up, and you're still on the same march. And you keep dropping, and you keep getting up, and it just goes on and on this way. So there has to be, like the Tibetans set up this Tulku system. Which, for those who come in the world who are bringing the truth, those they're expected to speak spiritual truth, and those who come to them, even as a child, they bow to them and they say, "I'm here to hear spiritual truth from you, no matter how strong it is." Now, this is a very important system that they set up. There's a lot of spiritual genius in the Tibetan Buddhism. That's why they've been so successful, is they allow teachers to come into the world and teach. How about that? What a concept, huh? They allow teachers to come into the world and teach? Amazing, huh? So the Tulkus, and they recognize incarnation, say, okay, you're going to be the head of this monastery because you were previously, and everyone recognizes that. Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodra. Okay, he's going to keep the Kenzi seat that Jamyang Kenzi Wangpo started. He's return of Jamyang Kenzi Wangpo, and so he's an action emanation. So he's going to inherit that seat. And it's his when once he gets old enough. So everybody treats him like you are the wisdom. You know, you're the guru, and he has to be trained severely, etc. But so guess what? He gets to say stuff, and people expect him to profess truth. This is how it's supposed to be. This is how it's supposed to be. That's why I say, like Zogchenpa president, he'll set the world up in the right way. So you can guess what? You can get incarnations. Teachers will come into such a world, into such a situation, because they're able to teach and profess. Whereas the system we have set up now, who's going to come into that? I'm not going to come into such a system again. No way. No way. Because the pressure again would be the same, but wouldn't be able to teach. Every parent would say, "Shut up! You're humiliating your grandmother. How dare you do that?" The Grande Dames, you know, they're the ones putting the pressure on everybody. The aging women, they can't stand the notion that they're not a graceful failure, and they put the pressure on their children. and everybody below them in age, and says, raise your children right. I want you to raise your children right. How dare you indulge them and let them say stuff like that? That was my grandmother on one side. The other side was saying, no, that's okay. He's saying wisdom stuff. So one of them, age is the Grande Dame, and the other one, age is just a hippie. And she was very helpful, that one. She had her sort of her own kookiness and stuff, but she didn't put the pressure on. What happened here? I don't know. It just went blank. She didn't. She allowed my parents to give me some slack. If I had two grandmothers like the Grande Dame, that is for sure. So my dad was able to, yeah. Went to, how are we doing here? We just stop or something? I don't know, it's just like freaking out. It's still going. It's doing all sorts of weird stuff. And we're just setting ourselves up. Our culture is totally setting itself up to generate the worst crop of Grande Dames in history. And this will crush any, you know, gurus coming into the world. They're trying to make sure that, you know, it doesn't happen anymore. Because you cannot have all your relatives and have all these Grande Dames, the aunties and grandmothers, etc., all putting the pressure on your parents to raise you the way they want you to be raised, which is to bow to their delusions and not see through it at all. Don't profess any truth, any inconvenient truths at all. That permeates the schooling system, it permeates society. So again, these Grande Dames, that's the worst thing there is in culture. They should say, don't say I'm aging gracefully, because I'm not. I'm not aging gracefully at all. I'm not having a graceful failure at all. I don't like it at all. So if someone said that, well, thank you. Thank you. At least you have some remedy for it. Oh, thank you. You know, I'm not going to the beauty parlor. I'm not going to pretend like this is great. I'm not happy. I'm not happy. The pressure that was put on my parents to raise me a certain way, you know, wrecked my life, really. But this princess culture, materialistic princess culture raising, this is going to absolutely stifle proper spiritual teaching in the world to an extreme extent. This is why I've been preaching against it so much. I mean, there's nobody who's going to, well, but it's already intense enough. Wow, isn't it, saying this? I don't need to push it anymore. The Tulku system, the reincarnation system of Tibetans, is the best way. Best way that I'm aware of, that is for sure. They right away, when the guru leaves, say, I'm going to reincarnate this place with these parents, etc., they already know, and says, and look for me. And then so those of the monastery, they go out at the right time, they know the date and everything. And they go to the parents, and there's the child, and they right away recognize this is the guru, and the parents have to accept this, that this is a reincarnation of the guru, and the aunts and uncles and grandmothers, everybody has to then kowtow. They have to say, yeah, this is the reincarnation of the guru, and expect the wow with the child. Nobody expected any wow with me. Nobody expected it at all. So every single person I met, they were always shocked. You know, what kind of system is that? It's a hideous system. Hideous. Whereas if people say, well, this is the Tulku, you recognize. Everywhere you go, everybody expects the wow. Oh, thank you. Thank you. And so they thank you instead of being furious at you. Or they stay away from you. One of the two. They avoid you. But everyone knows, well, you're avoiding them because they're tulku and you don't want spiritual instruction. That's why you're avoiding. So there's not some cachet for avoiding the tulku, you know. No, it means that you're, you know, trying to waste your life. And so you don't have some high social standing because you're ignoring it. Where here, everybody thinks that the more you ignore truth, the better social standing you have here. It's materialism is an extraordinarily wicked system where we refuse to acknowledge transmigration, reincarnation, the Tulku system, Rinpoche system, one insight settles it all this stuff. We refuse to recognize any of that. This is a devious, devious, devious system that only produces more and more misery. That's all it does. More and more misery, like an alcoholic drinking twice as much. You think that they're going to feel better from doing that? They think they are. But you know perfectly well, at some point, they'll realize, I'm just a wreck. I feel hideous. And it's the alcohol that did it. At some point, you know, or some don't, they try to transmigrate and hide it and become an alcoholic in some other realm and keep doing it. But at some point, they realize, wow, this just isn't working. It's horrible. So, I've heard some Tibetan Buddhists say that the Tulku system is collapsing, the Lama system's collapsing, and then they say, well, that's just the way it's going. Not so fast. From my experience, that's pie-in-the-sky idealism to say that it's okay if it collapses. We can all just be individuals do it. That's pie-in-the-sky. What they're saying is, well, maybe there is a graceful style. Maybe materialism is going to give us a really graceful style out. So some of these Tibetan Buddhists may be subtly becoming materialists. Just simply, because they just can't make any headway here. And I think they're really feel the pathos of it, you know. It's really tough. And so they say, well, maybe, you know, this is the way it's going, and we'll have to work this way. No. It's a stall out. Don't be tricked by it. Do not be tricked by it. You have to stick with that. The Tulku system is a fabulous system. The reincarnation system is a fabulous system. It's necessary to keep that going. Don't give in to the materialism. It's a fraud. It's a total fraud. It's a clever fraud. It's a creative fraud. But it's a simple, stupid, obvious fraud that just all it does is produces, again, worse misery. And then we say, well, great. This gives me another challenge to get comfortable with this. Yeah, right. You cannot have a Grande Dame society. You cannot have such a society. It's a disaster. Like I said, I won't be born into such a society again. I won't choose to do that. No way. It's bound to fail again. You know, you're just courting disaster, basically. Courting disaster. My parents were under so much pressure that they said they're going to have to send me away to a military boarding school. You know, there's some little real rough stuff in North Dakota or something, that boys camp or something. They said, you're just incorrigible. Well, they were under pressure from their in-laws and from relatives and stuff, in my case. They said, you're not raising them right. How dare you let them say these things to you? You know? My dad would listen. You know, they gave me some slack, but then he was put under so much pressure that he was caught between a rock and a hard place. And so I was constantly afraid that I would be orphaned. You know, they would just send me away into some brutal, you know, brutal orphanage that would just beat me into submission. I was constantly under that fear growing up. It caused me to have nervous breakdown. You can't. The Tulkus aren't afraid of that happening to them. I mean, come on. I mean, they think they don't know. I mean, the pressure you put under here. And the idea is that a child can just sit there going, I know God will take care of me, everything's fine. No, it doesn't work that way. You know, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was born into a family that accepted her. If you're in a family that totally rejects you, that's a little too rough. You'd have to be a perfect guru to handle that. And most tulkus are not perfect gurus. I mean, they're gurus, but they're not, you know, like Jesus. Okay, they're not Jesus. You know, maybe Jesus could handle such a situation. Probably could. But the idea is that nobody wants you, and you're just a total orphan. Even the boys' towns, even the military school won't take you. So you're just sitting by the side of the road. You know, that's possible, but you have to be perfectly enlightened to handle that. Established, you know, you have to be the highest kind of established. Otherwise, the pressure can be too much. Even for a tulku, it can become too much. They're given every advantage. It's helpful to give the teaching every advantage, because then you can profess more and more and more of it, you see. But to profess the heart of teachings when nobody listens to you is quite difficult. It's quite difficult. Keep in mind, all these great teachers, many people listen to them. But if you're professing truth and nobody's listening to you, this becomes brutally difficult. And what's the point of it? You say, what's the point of it? It's ridiculous. The thing is that people become used to listening to tulkus and rinpoches, and they don't listen to anybody else, which is fine. But if you're not a tulku or rinpoche, they don't listen to you. So, you know, maybe Longchenpa will give me an empowerment or something to help me out. But I don't. The Tibetan Buddhist, I would accept that. That doesn't work. So Longchenpa kind of, you know, abandoned Tibetan Buddhism. He said, hey, you know, they're very graceful. And that's not... So then where do you teach? You know, that's pretty tough to answer. I call it Dharma Kishan. Is trying to start a new tradition is not easy. You're part of all the Dharma tradition. Supersedes any particular tradition he's based on. But King tradition transcends that, supersedes it. So you're not stuck to any one talk of any one tradition. It's become that way. Remember, we're Atta Yoga to say we're already there. Everyone's already there. Actually, any regrets? It's okay. Well, it stopped. We already don't have any regrets.